always fun to be in a room with people who like to talk about marketing, because I love to talk about marketing. So we're going to do Marketing Essentials for Entrepreneurs. If you, I don't know how many of you had a chance to look through the slides. We're not going to cover everything there tonight. There's no way we would be able to do that. So what I've decided to do is cover a couple of key things that we have time for. I'd like this to be interactive. I don't want to be talking all the time. You probably don't want to hear me talk all the time. So I'd like to hear maybe about some of your experiences as it comes to marketing. Before we get going, let me just ask, how many of you have know what marketing is or have implemented a strategy for your business or have done it in corporate America? Anybody here? Okay. I've got a couple of people that know a little bit about it. Tonight, I am not going to be talking to you about digital marketing techniques, social media strategy, SEO, influencers. That stuff we'll save for another time. I'm here to talk about the fundamentals. And I think the other tools that are around, I mean, you see a plethora of tools in marketing has become much more. You can do a lot of things in the digital medium. You can do a lot of measuring of your performance in the digital medium. And I'm not going to be talking about that tonight. I want to talk about the fundamentals, because all these tools that you see and the technology you have are simply a vehicle for you to implement the fundamentals. And I will tell you that even though it's been a while since I was in business school, and I know, Bill, it's been a while for you too, but the fundamentals of what marketing strategy is have not changed. It is about trying to demonstrate value to your customer, communicate it in an effective way, and build trust, build a relationship with them so that they will buy from you over and over again. I mean, that's really what marketing is about. It's about establishing a relationship and a communication and a conversation. So I'll go. Just so that Bill already talked a little bit about me. I've been doing marketing for a long time. I bring a technical slant to it. I started out life as a power engineer, and I did some software development. So my angle is doing technical marketing. If you've ever spoken to engineers, and I'm an engineer, a lot of them, what they do is they talk about their product that they've made, and they think that this product is the greatest thing since sliced bread. For example, they'll talk about their, you know, people talk about iPhone, and it's got an A6 processor with an iOS that's just really cool, and it does all these things. And that's great if you're speaking to a technical audience, but the idea, and this is where I found that I had a niche, was taking what I call those product features, the things about the product that were interesting, the A6 processor, the dual flux capacitor, and all this other stuff, and convert it to benefits, something that your potential customer would understand. And you'd be surprised, maybe you wouldn't be surprised, how many people do not get that. That it's not about you. This is one thing you'll learn about marketing tonight as I talk. It is not about you. I'm sorry. It's about your customer. And everything that you're doing is a part of your strategy. If you're not thinking about your customer, then it's not a good strategy. So, just a little, that's about me. And as I've had to, over the years, bone up on some of the digital marketing techniques and social media. One of the things that I really enjoyed was doing some marketing analytics and taking a lot of data and doing analysis on that data to formulate marketing decisions, which is really interesting. We won't be talking about that tonight. These are the topics that I have in this presentation. And I think what we'll do is we'll just start going through them as we can. I'm not going to blow through them. We may save these for another time. I think the first two we have to definitely do. We'll talk about the value concept of value proposition and understanding your target market. Because I think those are probably the two most misunderstood concepts when people think about marketing or when they're implementing marketing initiatives for their company. And then if we have time, we'll go through some of these other ones. Otherwise, I'll save them for another presentation that hopefully you all will show up and see. So why do I need a marketing strategy? Anybody have any thoughts about why do we need a marketing strategy? Sorry? Okay, to differentiate yourself from your competitors? Yeah? Yes, sir?
Well, you need a strategy so that your money is not wasted.
Right.
That you contingent on what's going to be best for you, you know.
Well, why are you spending that money?
Because you want to get customers. You want to make money back from them.
Okay.
That's why I'm saying you don't want to waste your money.
Right.
You know, you want to make sure that you're hitting the people that want to buy your product.
Right. Well, the whole thing, the point there is that there's a concept there that I wanted to make sure everybody understood, because there's a lot of business owners that when you tell them they need to spend money on marketing, they don't understand why they have to spend any money on marketing. There's many that feel that marketing is, again, they go, so why do I need a marketing strategy? Now, I've seen that look on many business owners' faces. They don't get it as to why they need it. What I've typically heard is, my business, I've got all the customers I can handle right now. Okay, that's good. But I would submit to you that if you don't have a marketing strategy or you haven't thought about how you're going to go about marketing your company will never grow. You probably stay with the same amount of customers that you've always had, and business will stay a flat line. Marketing is, having a marketing strategy is essential for your company to grow and to get more customers. Okay, well, just give a few of these, and we've talked about it. Marketing is essential. We talk about customer engagement. Now, when we say customer engagement, you hear these words. Anybody have any thoughts about what that means? If you're engaging a prospective client, you're talking to a prospective client, and you're trying to engage them, what is it that you're trying to do? What does that mean? Anyway, yes?
Well, to me, it can mean that you're looking for the particular need of that customer.
Okay.
And all right. Once you find out the need, then you know whether or not your company can supply that need. You want to narrow down to that particular need and make sure that you can give them what they're looking for.
Right. That's great. What you just said is really very important. And the point you said about it, did everybody hear that, is that you need to understand what your customer's need is. Okay? That's important. Before, as you're engaging your customer and you're trying to build a relationship with them, you have to understand what their needs are and what matters to them. How are you going to help them move their business forward? How are you going to provide value to them? Value in something that they need and they understand, and the way it's measured, and we'll talk about it, it's measured in their terms, not yours. If you're able to do that and do the research to understand your customer and their business pains and what's driving their business, and then you can take either the product or service that you're selling and demonstrate that you can help your customer achieve their goals, that in and of itself will probably be a very successful marketing strategy. But it's about building a relationship with the customer. We typically, even smarter, typically, well, let's just look at it. If you are purchasing a very expensive item, you're buying a car, even though you know, it's gonna be a process that you go through before you buy that car, or you buy a house, or any type of thing that purchase that's of high value to you, you're gonna go through a process where you're going to probably engage with the manufacturer or the supplier to some degree to understand how their product is gonna fit your needs. And chances are, someone that comes to you and demonstrates that they understand what you're going through, what your pain points are, and what your needs are, you're going to gravitate towards that person because they understand you. And that's one thing, I think, a basic need that we all have is we want to be understood or someone to really know us. So that hasn't changed. I would say that's a fundamental part of marketing. Being able to do that, you will grow your sales, which leads to revenue, okay? And if you've done your marketing well, it's going to be profitable then. Does anybody know why, if you do your marketing well, why it would lead to profitable revenue? Anyone have a thought? thoughts about that? Yeah.
Less likely to compete on price.
Okay.
If you find the right customers.
Right.
For your value propositions.
So you're really, you're competing, so if you're not competing on price, what are you competing on? If I?
Value.
Value, that's right, that's right. So what you'd be able to demonstrate is you're delivering a certain amount of value to your customer, and they're willing to pay for it. Would you spend, if I could show you that if you spent $1,000 on my product and I could show you I could deliver $25,000 to your business every year, would that be something you might sign up for? I might even be able to get $5,000 for that. But the whole thing is that demonstrating the value allows you to grow and develop profitable revenue. And a profitable business, or a business that is not profitable, is not sustainable and it won't grow. In fact, it'll go out of business. So you want to be able to be profitable, and what my point would be is, if you want to have a profitable business where you're delivering value that your customer understands, you've got to have a good marketing strategy. And this is a U.S. Air Force Special Ops pilot. You can't build products or establish services, not do marketing, and hope that customers are going to come. Okay? Hope is not a strategy. It's not going to work. You have to actively invest time and money in developing your messaging, in developing your complete initiatives to reach out to your customer to communicate your value. Okay, I'm not going to get too hung up on this slide. You can look at it in the handout. All of it to say here. When I meet with a client, I typically go through three processes or three phases to bring them a marketing strategy about. The first phase, we talk assessment and analysis. It's one of those things that we come into a business and usually what the prospective client says, I think I need some marketing, or they don't even say that. They'll say, my business is generating is not at the level that I want it to be. Or I've got this product, I think this is a target market for it, this is a customer I think would be interested in, and I need to find out whether that's true or not. And what I want to say is that when I meet with a client, typically we go through an assessment period where we need to understand what it is that you're trying to accomplish. What are your business goals? And what is a good, if you were going to spend some money on marketing or on marketing strategy, what would be a good outcome? And that's really important. I want to stress that because there's a lot of marketing firms out there, there's a lot of them here in the Raleigh-Durham area that are more focused on the tactics. They'll come to your business and say, you know what? You need a social media strategy. And you'd be like, wow, maybe I do. I don't know why. And you know, it just so happens that we do social media strategies. And they don't take a holistic view of your business and trying to understand what your business goals are. Maybe a social media strategy is what you need, but we won't know it until we understand your business and what your business goals are and what you're currently doing. So that's what we say about the assessment piece. Then we go to where we formulate the strategy, where we've determined, okay, we understand what the business goals are, we know what you're currently doing, and we also know a little bit about what the current beliefs about your company are in the marketplace, both from customers, employees, and other people that may be associated with your business. And through that, we identify the gaps between the business goals and what you're doing to put together a strategy. And that's going to be a multi-pronged thing. There's many initiatives that we will do to achieve the goals. And one of the things, we won't get to talk about it tonight, but one of the things that we do spend a lot of time on doing is putting together what we call KPIs. KPIs are key performance indicators. And they are measurements that we would make on, we're doing, we're executing on marketing initiatives, we want to be able to measure, are we moving in the right direction? Are we achieving progress? And what I would tell you is that with the technology and tools that are available nowadays, measuring your progress from a marketing standpoint could never be easier. So then the third phase we get into is really the implementation phase. We've identified the initiatives that we need to execute on, and it's time to go execute them. And this is where we, again, we do, as we're executing, we measure the results and we adjust as needed. This is a lot different from back in the old days. If you, for example, in some of the large companies, they would spend a fortune on some brochures, or they would spend a fortune on a TV ad. And they would spend this, but they never, ever, unfortunately, because before the days of technology, they really could never measure the reach that they had or the level of engagement that they had with this marketing collateral. Now, with the digital medium, it's amazing the things you can do in terms of measuring how well the customer is engaging with you and your company. Any questions on this? Is this, again, you can read this. I just want to show you a flow chart, if you would, of how to go about putting together a strategy from a particular situation. Okay, let's talk about value proposition. One of my favorite subjects in marketing, and I think it's one of the most misunderstood, so we'll see. Okay, let's just start. Why don't we talk about definitions? Because I like to break things down. I think it helps for people to understand. What do you think value, what does value mean?
Worth,
okay. Can you expand on that a little bit? I like to say value as it relates to you're buying something or products and services. What do you think value means?
If you're buying a diamond versus a custom jewelry,
mm-hmm.
Well, you expect to pay more for that diamond than the custom jewelry.
Right.
So the value that the diamond brings is it lasts,
mm-hmm.
has deadness,
mm-hmm.
it's beautiful, it's not going to deteriorate with time.
Right.
So you got different things that make it valuable.
Okay.
But
how about, let me ask you, why would a real diamond be more valuable to you than a cubic zirconia? And I think it's more than just the diamond itself.
Yeah. Well, if something happened, it would bring you more value if you're going to sell it.
Right.
If you want to, some of it is personal.
Well, yeah, I was saying, how about you wearing it at a party and you know that that's a real diamond ring on my finger?
Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
It makes me feel good.
Yeah. So that's, it's valuable to you.
It's very valuable.
Value is not just dollars and cents. Yes, sir.
I think value, it's an interesting question. It has a lot to do with what you're willing to sell it for and what you're willing to pay for it. Because it's based upon what your needs, you know, or what your aspirations, you consider
right.
this as an important thing.
Right.
So it has to do with personal, you know, relationships. Because like, you know, for instance, if I have a workshop and a particular tool, and I go to a yard sale, right, you got to negotiate with the person what's it worth.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know that what it's worth on the open market, but what are you willing to and what is he willing to sell it for?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's one of the interesting things about value, because it's not intrinsic. It's not in the thing itself.
Well, no, it's not intrinsic. And I would say to you, suppose, for example, here's another thing to think about, a twist on what you just said. You got that tool. Suppose that the tool itself, I guess it's what willing people willing to pay. Well, scarcity could determine that too. Suppose that's the only tool that exists on this whole planet.
Well, that's right.
Then all of a sudden, it's a lot more valuable. Or if it's the only tool, say, or it's a tool that this person has, and it's the only tool that's going to help you get solve some big problem that you need to solve.
Then it has a lot more value to you than some other tool.
And chances are, because it's going to help, it's going to solve a big problem for you, you might be willing to pay more for that.
Right, like your example of the $1,000 to make the 20 mile.
Right.
You know?
Right. Okay. Yes.
Another important thing about value, what's valuable to you may not be valuable to me.
That's right. That's exactly right.
You may see that tool that somebody's selling at a yard sale or whatever, and I can look at it and it means nothing to me.
Right.
You know, but you walked in behind me and said, wow, I was looking for that.
Right.
And I'm willing to pay X, Y, Z because it took me a while. So supply and demand determines some value too.
Right. You know? Well, and here's another thing just to tie into what you said. Remember I talked about the iPhone.
Mm-hmm.
I would tell you, suppose I told you, okay, the iPhone's got an A6 processor on it. Who cares? But if I tell you the iPhone is a cool way for you to put appointments in your calendar, and it's got an alarm on it that will tell you when you're going to go to your next meeting, or it allows you to send a mess email or something like that. Now that's something you're interested in hearing about. But you know, we're still talking about the same product.
Same phone, yes.
But it's just we're talking about it differently.
Different feature.
Yeah. Now there's the techie guys that really care about that stuff. And gals too. So that's the point. You're right. Value is a very subjective thing. And that's the point that I want to make, is that when you're thinking about your value proposition, you have to think about it in terms of what your target customer measures value. Okay? So what's proposition? When we think of the word proposition in this context, anybody have some thoughts about that?
Proposal,
made an offer, maybe it's a communication about your value. Okay? It's an answer to this question, how does my product or service deliver value to my customer? Okay? You notice it doesn't say here, how does my product or service work? We're not asking that question. It's how is it delivering value to my customer? Really important. It seems true, but this is a really important concept that a lot of people get wrong. Value can be characterized a number of ways. I'm going to talk about a couple of common ways. What you're selling to the customer can help him or her improve their sales, increase their sales, help them sell more of their products, okay, or increase their business, grow their revenue, or what you're doing can help reduce costs that they have, so that for a given amount of revenue, their profitability will increase, because profit is revenue minus costs, or there's a pain. There's some pain that the customer is dealing with. It may not be associated with either one of these, but it's a pain that's dogging their business. And if you've got an answer to it, you've got an answer that's going to help them alleviate that pain, that is going to be of huge value to them. Okay? Everybody got that? Okay. That's just really important. And what this young woman alluded to earlier about trying to understand what your customers' pains are and what they need. It's important for you to understand, as you're engaging with your target market, how do they measure value? What is it? And you have to measure it in their terms. Very important. I'll give a couple of examples, or some that I'd like to talk about here. y'all heard of this company. You know what I just realized? I've been doing business with this company for a long time, but I just finally got this A to Z thing. I didn't get that. But that's it. I mean, somebody said A to Z. So, what do you think Amazon's value proposition is?
Ease of use, accessibility.
Mm-hmm.
Satisfaction of customer.
Okay.
And most importantly, make sure the customer is satisfied.
Well, let me ask you, let me just think about it. Think of some of the businesses that Amazon's changed or put out of business. Mm-hmm. I think what they're desired to be, they want to be your go-to source for just about anything.
Mm-hmm. Coming.
Yeah. I mean, let's face it, you're thinking about buying something, chances are you're going to go to Amazon and check it out, right? Mm-hmm. And this company, 25 years ago, this company wasn't around. Mm-hmm. Didn't exist. Okay? Any other thoughts about Amazon?
I think they focus on meeting the needs of the public, not in a small way, but in a very massive way.
Mm-hmm.
So what you didn't see on Amazon 10 years ago when they first started,
mm-hmm.
you can click and find
right.
on Amazon now,
right.
and their reliability, you know, they back up who, you know, the source, the business
right.
that they allow to list with them. So you have to have some type of credibility and some type of history so that, you know, their name is well protected.
Oh, yes.
You know? So you just don't go on there and think you're going to do whatever you want to do.
No.
Because they will shut you down off of their side. You can go wherever else you want to go.
But you're not going to tarnish the Amazon.
You tarnish the brand.
Right, not going to tarnish the
brand. They become
right.
a household brand.
Right. Okay, well, I would say probably their value proposition is that we can be your go-to source for just about anything, and if you want to be a prime, we can have it on your doorstep in 2 days. I mean, you never have to leave your house if you don't want. Okay. All right, how about this company? What do you think their value proposition is?
Money. Revenue. Money.
They're printing money, that's no doubt about that.
Value. They do have a value.
What do you think? I mean, what is it that, what do they deliver to customers?
Cutting edge technology.
Okay.
Yeah. The leader, I guess, in the technology, computers and phones.
Yeah, cutting edge products.
Cutting edge.
That are look really cool. And they, anything else about, do you think, what, anything else about how they deliver value?
Simplifying life.
Yeah.
It's simpler with technology.
Yeah, no, but thank you. Well, right.
That's I think their market though is that they're trying to.
They want you to believe
that's
that.
Part of their sales pitch, just that you know, you get an app for this, and it's going to make your life easier.
Well, we're going to talk a little bit, if we do get some time, we may talk about competitive advantage. I would say with Apple, too, is that Apple does a great job. You're right. I think that I got a MacBook, and I had a Windows machine before. I had all kinds of problems with my Windows machine, with incompatibility with software, and all kinds of different kinds of issues. Got the blue screen to death a few times. And, you know, with my MacBook, never had a problem. Because they truly believe I think one of the things they've tried to focus on too is selling their products to a more or less technical market segment that doesn't. They figure it's our job, Apple. It's our job to solve these problems so these people don't have to. Whereas Microsoft and other Windows-based machines, not so much. So I think that's one of the key things that Apple does.
I agree. Apple has a reputation among artists as being very easy to use, musicians.
Right.
You know.
Right. And their products are cool too. They're really, they're sleek. Okay. All right. Anybody here, some of you business owners, we've talked about value proposition and how you deliver value. Would anybody like to venture, tell the group what you think your value proposition is? Yes, sir.
I don't mind sharing.
Yeah.
I'm new in town. I only moved here about a month ago, and I had a very successful business in New York, the Science Wizard. And so it's kind of entertainment, but it's really education. So I sell it as stealthy education. Yet kids think they have one, but they're learning.
Okay.
So I think it's a pretty good hook.
So the deal is delivering value is you're making education fun, learning fun. Anybody else? Yeah.
My company develops custom software for businesses. So our value proposition is, delivering on our clients' visions.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, they don't have them even written down. So we interview them. We do all the VA work up front. And if they want to turn that into an RFP and put it out for bid, fine. Then just pay us for the discovery.
Pay for the consulting, yeah.
Delivering on time efficiently and complete transparency throughout the process. So we don't require them to assign a project manager or anything like that. We will continually give you updates on the exact status.
And that's good. You're talking a little bit how you're doing business with the customer, but let me kind of push you on that a little bit. What are you helping them do?
Well, if you're a new CIO, which is really our target, you generally have big plans,
mm-hmm.
and maybe a support staff, developers, but not a staff that's used to building things from the ground up, whether it's replacing legacy software or anything else. So if you want to make an impact quickly, you can outsource to our company.
Okay.
So that's the sort of the new CIO thing. And then the value proposition, of course, there's always internal tools people want that increase efficiency of their employees.
Mm-hmm.
And some startups, we're helping them conceptualize their ideas,
mm-hmm.
and get them off the ground.
So maybe if I hear you saying some of your software helps streamline some of their business processes, would that be a fair statement?
Yeah, and just solving problems that they can't find off the shelf software for.
Okay, all right. So you're the kind of go-to, and you help them navigate all of that. What I would call the maze of software tools, because I look at them, it's like, I have no idea.
Yeah, no, me either. As one of two owners, I'm the biggest, the least technical person in the company, so I'm not burdened with all that technical knowledge.
Okay.
So I can speak in the business language.
Okay.
I know enough to be dangerous and to make sure that the communication is happening.
Thank you for sharing. What I would encourage you to do is, you're thinking about the value proposition for your business, you would start it with, we help customers blank. Okay? And it doesn't, and let's just go here. I've got this little graphic about what your value proposition is. It's the intersection of the marketplace offerings, then your offering, and what the customer needs. I think it's pretty good. But let me tell you what your value proposition is not. It's not a statement about you or your company. Okay? That's not your value proposition. Because it's your mission. That could be your mission statement. That's not your value proposition.
Right.
Okay? Your product or service features. That's not your value proposition. And your company's position versus the competition, that is not your value proposition. That is your competitive advantage. It's all about how you, your company, how you help your customers achieve their goals. Okay? Everybody got that? Okay. let's go to the, just keep mindful of time here, okay, we're just 8:30?
8:30.
Okay, good. All right, let's go to another subject that I think is very, very important and gets confused and convoluted and misunderstood, and it's understanding what your target market is. How many of you have heard someone at a networking meeting, or somebody had a, you know, you're at a cocktail party or a family gathering, and someone says, you know, I've got this great product. It's, you know, I've come up with it, I've got a prototype, I think it's the greatest thing since sliced bread. And I'm like, well, really? Yeah, it's cool. And I said, so yeah. He goes, and everybody's gonna buy it. Everybody is gonna buy it. Because everybody's gonna want it. How many people have you heard that? I mean, have you heard this thing, oh, everybody's gonna buy it? Okay. Well, I wanna tell you, you're gonna hear it here first, okay? Whoops. All right. When you say, I can sell to everybody, that equals you're selling to nobody. Okay? You have to have a target market, and it can't be everybody in the world. Because that's exactly how many people are going to understand and respond to your marketing message, if you say everybody.
That doesn't include Apple.
Well, actually, no, I mean, Apple, well, not everybody buys Apple products. Android got a pretty big market share. So, there's a lot of window machines out there. So how big is your target market? Anybody ever given some thought into that? How to go out and say, well, how big is the market that I want to sell to? Anybody got any thoughts on that? You know, tackled that at all?
I'm starting to. I'm a therapist, psychotherapist.
So, oh, right, okay.
I got some statistics about like the zip code area and the population within there. Kind of identifying.
But I would say there's probably your skills as a psychotherapist, you are probably trained to serve, to deal with certain types of situations. Obviously, you can't deal with every psychological or situation out there.
Not every one, but...
Certain ones you'd probably be good at, right?
Better than others, yeah.
Better than others, okay. So you've been using the geographical... way to kind of whittle down to see where they might be.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, let's talk about this, because I think there's a process that you can go through to understand your target market. Okay. And I'm going to do it through an example. There's several ways you can look at this. There's three acronyms to deal with your target market. There's a thing called the TAM, which is the total addressable market. That is, say for you, if we take your psychotherapist example, I would say that the total addressable market is going to be all the people out there that need therapist services, okay, within a given market. I mean, you could say in the United States, in North Carolina, or whatever, okay? That's all the people out there that need psychotherapist services, right? Now, that would probably be way too big of a market for you to go after. You wouldn't have the bandwidth. You would have to spend ungodly amounts of money to try to market to an audience that big. So we have to break it down. So we go to what we call the SAM, serviceable addressable market. And that would be, if we take your psychotherapist example again, maybe that would be the people that you're trained to handle specific situations. all the people that are, have that particular situation that they need therapy for. Okay? And that's still gonna probably be a very big market, okay? But that's your addressable market, meaning that if I could reach all of those people with my marketing initiatives, I think I would have a really good chance of succeeding in having them buy my product or service. I am, my product or service is tailored for them, okay? Then we have what we call the share of the market. And that's basically your share. Those are your sales. That is the fraction of the serviceable market, addressable market, that are your customers, okay? So it's important to understand the size of these three. You'll hear people say SAM, TAM, and that's what they're talking about. Everybody got that? Let's do an example. I'm going to do one for my company, and as Bill alluded to, I do marketing strategies, and I do technology companies, and I do it for IT networking, software development, and energy, electric power, and renewables. Those are just areas that I have a technical background in. So I want to figure out what my size of my target market is, okay, for marketing strategy services. Okay, I might want to look at all the technology companies in the United States. How many think that would probably be a good strategy? That'd be a lot of companies, huh? That would be way too big. Okay. But it might be nice to know, if I could, and I heard the thing about Reference USA, which is a great resource, I'll just tell you right now, I've used it many times, to find out about companies and find out their revenue, employee size, their geographic location. It's amazing. Resource. All right, but that's too big. I can't handle that, okay? All right, maybe I'm gonna size it down. I'm gonna look at technology companies in North Carolina. What do you think? Still too big? Yeah. Yeah, it's still too big, yeah. All right. How about I am going to look at renewable energy and energy efficiency companies in North Carolina. Okay, much better. That brings it down quite a bit. And really what it is I found out, I've done it, what I've decided in my business, I have decided, okay, these are the kinds of companies that I know I can help, okay? So they're the ones I'm gonna do the research on to make sure I understand what they're, how they measure value and value means to them. All right, so this is what we're going to use, okay. And that's reasonable. So this is just a little diagram showing most of the renewable energy and energy efficiency companies. Spot in the triangle, Charlotte, we got Asheville over here, Greensboro, Winston-Salem, all the metropolitan areas in North Carolina. That seems reasonable. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna figure out how big that is. And how big of it, and how much SAM and how much was shared for me, I want to know how much of an addressable market I can have, okay? All right, so I do a little bit of research and you can find this stuff. You don't have to spend money on very expensive marketing studies. A lot of this information is available through just typing in Google and you'll find some of this information. You come to the library here, they have a huge number, ton of databases that can help you with this work that I'm talking about.
Yes.
So.
Yes. Come say hello.
Yeah, I mean, so let the library, get a library card, the library could be your friend. Okay? All right, I do some secondary research. And what I mean by secondary research means that there's what we call primary research and secondary research. Primary research is original research that's done on a particular subject. I'm creating new information, but I'm not doing that yet. Secondary research is I'm leveraging work that other people have done. I'm researching, I'm going out and doing the research, but I'm pulling out reports of things that other people have done. And I can do some secondary research, and I have done it, that renewable energy companies in North Carolina, they did $6.4 billion in revenue. It's a lot of money. You may think, oh wow, that's a huge market. But they didn't spend all that. That's their total revenue. So we've got to drill down some more. I did some more research, and I looked at technology companies. And I wanted to know how much they spend on marketing in a year. And I found the average was around 10% of revenues they spend on marketing. Other industries will spend a different percentage, but for technology, 10%. All right, so doing 10% of that, all right, we're down to $640 million. So that's all the marketing dollars, the marketing spend that is done. All right, I still need to do more. All right, what I've assumed, and you can read reports, there's a little bit of, you may argue about this, but I said, okay, of the marketing spend that these companies, of the dollars that these companies spend on marketing, I'm an outside guy, they're gonna outsource to me. All right, well, I'd say 5% of their marketing spend is for outsourced, okay? The rest of it is some of these companies that they have their own internal marketing resources, they're paying their salaries, they're doing the initiatives on their own, they don't want to farm it out. But 5% of it, they'll farm out, which I think is pretty conservative. All right, that brings $32 million. So, That is my service, SAM, serviceable addressable market. 32 million. That's not bad. It's a good market for small business. All right, do some more research. More secondary research. I was at the library, found this out. The average spend. I wanted to find out, one of the things you might want to find out is and this helps with your pricing too. We're not going to get into pricing tonight, unfortunately, but you want to find out what is the average spend that a customer would spend with you. And say in a year, okay? I said for marketing strategy services and marketing consulting, all right? They're going to spend $750 per month, and that equates to $9,000 per year. This is average. Okay. So if that's true that each customer spends $9,000 a year, that means I got a total of about 3,500 customers that I can talk to in the state of North Carolina. I mean it's a rough calculation, but at least it gives you an idea of how many people you need to reach, or maybe potentially reach. So for mine, the total addressable market is $32 million in revenue, and I got 3,532 customers. Everybody see that? Very important that you go through this analysis for your business. Okay? Because you want to ensure, one of the things, and you alluded to it, you're going to be spending money on marketing. Whether you do it yourself, or you hire somebody, or you bring in somebody on to do it, you're still going to be spending money. There's a thing that we talk about called the marketing return on investment. And you want to make sure that your investment is positive, the return on investment is positive. Okay? And in order to do that, you need to understand what the value for every customer that you bring to the business. What is that number? For me, if I bring every customer I bring is $9,000. So if I bring 10 new customers in, or say 20 new customers in, let's just say 10 for now just to make it an even number, that's $90,000. Chances are, I'm going to spend, if I can bring in 10 new customers as a result of my marketing efforts, I will probably spend $10,000 to $15,000 on some marketing thing that's going to bring me $90,000 in revenue or new customers. So we'll talk more about that. But it's, that's, that, it's important for you to understand this in order to get a sense of what your return on investment is going to be.
So this is really a strategy to define your marketing budget.
Right. Yeah, I don't know if we're going to get time to get into the budget tonight, but it, this doing something like this helps you size up a marketing budget. So that, so for example, if you were spending, you know, you said you're going to get 10 new customers, but it cost you $100,000 to get 10 new customers, well, that's probably not the right thing to be doing. You just lost $10,000. So, but
because money you spend, that doesn't return.
Right. Yeah, if you're not bringing in, if the money you spend is not bringing in new customers, because that's what you want, that is really the goal. The goal of a marketing strategy, and it's funny, people say, what do you want, what is the goal, what's the goal of your marketing strategy? And so they always say, increase sales. That's not the goal of a marketing strategy. That's the goal, that increase sales, that's what your sales force has to do. The key thing, the goal of marketing strategy is you arm your sales force so they can go out and make those sales. Okay. Talk about getting to know your target market. We've kind of hammered this home earlier. As we're looking at them and you're doing your research, you want to be able to say, what do they care about? Now, I will say one of the things that you may say, well, how do I find that out? Well, let me ask, in fact, I won't answer that. Let me throw that question out. How would you find out what your target audience, what do they care about? How would you find that out?
You could ask.
You could ask? Okay, that's one way. Any other thoughts on how you would want to find out? It's your target audience. And you're trying to sell to them, so you got to find out what they care about. So what would you do?
Surveys.
Okay, you could do surveys, yeah. That's assuming they're going to respond to your survey.
Yeah.
You know, good luck with that.
Yeah.
Yes?
You can go to companies that work in an area like you're looking to do, mm-hmm. and talk to them and see what their strategies are to bring people in.
Right.
And you can use that information to see what is this what you want to do.
Right. The point is you're going to have to do some homework. Okay? Whether it's talking to people, surveys, asking, doing your own research, you're going to have to find out what they care about. There's just, you can't get around it. And what are their business pains? What one of the things that I think is always good when you're trying to approach a prospective client, and I've done this too, is to do some research on what's going on in their industry. Maybe there's some interesting things happening from a regulatory standpoint. Maybe there's been some recent acquisitions, or you know, the marketing or the competitive landscape has changed. It's always good to come in and talk to, if you talk to a prospective customer, to show that you've done some homework. And even if you don't get all the details right, they'll usually give you a pass on that because they can tell that you've taken some time to understand them. Where are they located? Online and offline. One of the things we talk about with online, with social media, and there's some in the back of the presentation, there are some tools and websites you can go to find out who your key influencers are on social media. If you just type in a keyword, they'll tell you what some of the influencers are, what they're talking about, because there's another way. And I would say that from this standpoint that most businesses nowadays are leveraging digital media. I mean, it's here to stay. It's not going anywhere. And I think that spending some time looking at who the influencers are online, and what they're talking about should be part of your research that you do. And then the other key thing that you want to understand, how does your target market get their information? Do they get it from some of them, you know, I'm just going to ask you, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but how would you say some of your prospective clients or your business, how would they get their information about you?
Yeah, listings on like Psychology Today has therapist listings. There's other ones out there. Google, because it's got like phone floors, it could find one close by.
Now there's a thing that you talk is that that is what I call inbound marketing, which is that you put your information out there, and if people are looking for it, they'll find it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but that's one strategy. That's assuming the key assumption there is people are looking for it. What about the people that are not looking for it?
Word of mouth, friends, family.
Okay. No. But it's important that you understand for your target market, how do they get their information? Could be industry websites, industry associations. But it's just you need to, because wherever they're getting their information, that's where you need to be. Communicating your message. Okay. I love this. This is the marketing funnel. I love this is a kind of a great way to show the marketing process, and we start with awareness, we move to engagement. Now awareness is people are, like it just says, they're aware of you. Okay, they see you out there. Maybe they've seen your website, maybe, or someone, you're at a networking meeting or something and you get a chance to talk to somebody about how you help businesses. But there's just an awareness piece. That's usually the initial engagement with a marketing, a firm and a prospective client. Then we move to what we call the engagement phase. And the engagement phase is that they start interacting with you. You start to build a relationship. Maybe maybe you had a phone call or you had a visit with them. Or maybe they've come to your website and you find out that they're on your website looking around and they engage with the content and maybe they download something, maybe they watch a video on the site. Or if it's an e-commerce site, maybe they've got a cart and they leave something in there or they've liked something. But the whole point is they're engaging with you. Okay? Then we move to the discovery phase. And this is when the phase where the client or the prospective customer discovers and realizes that your product or service could fulfill their needs. But they may also realize there's other people out there that could also fill their needs. You still have competition. But this is the point where the customer decides, I think you might have what I need. Okay, they've come to that realization. Then there is the next phase is the purchase. They become a customer. Okay? That's great, that's always good. But then, once they become a customer, then we have what we call the retention piece. If they're a customer, what do we have to do to make them stay being a customer? Okay? One of the things that you'll need to understand in order to move through this funnel is to understand your customer's buying process. How do they buy? Do they have to go through all of these? I mean, how, what do these particular levels, and they are all there in some form or fashion. How do they buy a product or service like yours? And then, the other part that's really important is how are you going to provide value to them, pieces of value to them, to move them through. So, if they're at the awareness stage, you're going to provide them some value in some way to get them to engage with you, okay? So, for example, I'll give you just a way they might do it. It's like, you go to a website, you know how many websites you've gone to that if you give them your name and email address, you can download a white paper or you can download a PDF document, right? Yeah. That's a way. So what they've done is they've given you some value. They've given you some information that might help you in exchange for your contact information. So they move to engagement. Then we have to have more value to move them through the discovery stage where they finally realize that through more of the engagement and more value that you have something that I can use. Customers think. And that's the point, is that there is value that you have to provide, and what I'm saying is your marketing strategy has to account for and be able to deliver this value at every step in this process. Okay. Why don't we talk a little bit about differentiators here? Just keep going. I want to start with we're going to talk about a little bit about differentiation and your competitive advantage. I'm going kind of fast. Again, you could spend, there's whole courses at university that talk about these concepts here, but I'm going kind of fast, but we'll just keep going. So definition, differentiators, I'm just going to read the unique features and or benefits of a product or service or aspects of a brand that set it apart from competing products or brands. So there's a few words that I highlighted that I thought were really important. Features, benefits, aspects of a brand that and set it apart. Anybody have any thoughts about that? Yes, sir.
My tutoring business. I advertise, I tell people that I don't just teach a subject, I teach the kid how to learn.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a big thing.
Right.
You know, I think as a parent, I would say, hey, this guy's putting himself out of business.
Well, and then the thing is, you would say, in the context of being the differentiator, to talk about how what's unique about the way you do things as compared to other people that are providing services similar to yours.
Right.
So, okay, and then I got a question. Your unique differentiator answers this question. Why should prospective customers buy from you versus the competition? You'd be surprised at how many businesses, and I'm talking some major Fortune 500 companies, that cannot answer that question. It's amazing. And I would say that is part of the thing that you really need to understand. And here, so we'll talk a little bit about some differentiation factors here, some things that, common ways that we can differentiate ourselves from our competitors in the marketplace. The first one is product or service features. And I call that, it's a bigger, better, faster product. Ours is technically superior, or it's got better features. It is, for example, you know, how we differentiate Mercedes-Benz versus Chevrolet. Okay, they're clearly differentiated in a lot of different ways, but one of them is that the Mercedes-Benz, I would say, is probably a much better made car. Okay, so that's one way. Another way, we alluded to, price. We can always differentiate on price. But if we're selling something valuable, and we believe is valuable, you don't really want to have to be differentiated on price. That is, if that's it, typically, you know, differentiation on price is that you've got a bunch of competitors similar to you, and you're all offering identical things. And so the only way that you can stand out is on price. There's other ways you can get around that, but that's in a very crowded, what we call a very crowded marketplace. Good, better, best. And then demographics. There's a way that you are differentiate yourself, that you have focused on a particular market segment, and you're telling that particular market segment that I am focused on you. I care about you, and my competitors don't care about you. And I can show you that. Okay, that they are, you're totally focused on that. So that's another way you can differentiate yourself. I'll give you an example. One of the ways I differentiate Roar is there's a lot of people doing marketing strategy out there here in the Triangle, but there's not a lot of people that have a technical background that can get down the weeds from a technical standpoint, convert those complex technical features into benefits. A lot of companies, but I can, so that's what I figure is one of my biggest differentiators. Okay. Other ways you can differentiate yourself on your experience or expertise, if you have some special training or any type of thing that your competition doesn't, and the prospective customer cares about that, that is clearly a differentiator there. The customer experience. There is a aspect of it of, we talked about originally about differentiating on price, which is a way that you can separate yourself from the pack. But one of the things that you might do is you might offer, instead of, you may say, Mr. Customer, I'm gonna charge a little bit higher price for my product than my competition, but I'm gonna give you some other services in addition to the product. Or I'm gonna work on something so that the customer experience, whatever it is, and when I talk about the customer experience, I talk about all the interactions that you have with a particular brand, both online, offline. One of the big ones is, especially when you're thinking about, you're doing your evaluation, do they answer your questions well, to your satisfaction? Do they give you the information that you need? Also, if you've bought a product and you had a problem when you tried to call them about it, did anybody answer the phone? Did they act like they cared? And these are all huge differentiators. Because I would tell you, I would bet you, how many of you have ever helped that you bought something, great product, but then you tried to call because you needed some help, or maybe you didn't understand something, how to use it? And if you could get somebody, if you could get a live person, that would be a miracle. But say you didn't get the information you needed. How do you feel about that company and the product then? They clearly differentiate themselves. Okay, I'm not going to get this in the. I will get these to you, Bill. There's some great differentiation examples here. This is a link to a paper or an article I have that talks about some great examples. I will tell you, there is one in there that I'd love to ask you because I think you guys will have. They talk about Whole Foods has done a great job in this author's mind of differentiating themselves. Anybody have any thoughts on how Whole Foods differentiates themselves from other supermarkets or market store, grocery stores?
Local food.
Local food, okay. Any thoughts about, okay, when you go into the, when you go into a Whole Foods store, what's different about it as compared to, say, a Harris Teeter? Staff, the whole layout, you know, the big food bar, that's clearly a differentiator, and they're going after a certain target audience. Okay. Well, so when you get the thing, I'll give it to you, you can read it. It's a really interesting article. Okay, let's go back to Amazon again. Well,
they lowered their prices.
Because, I mean, if it's Express being in the store, then going to Amazon would not get that anymore.
Well, I would say, you know, I think you've read, though, that Amazon's going to, they're putting stores, like they've got, I think they're building a, opening a store in San Francisco, and they've opened a few in other metropolitan areas. I mean, I think that, with Amazon buying Whole Foods, if I was in the senior management at Harris Teeter and Kroger, I'd be a little nervous. Because Amazon is huge. They and look at the businesses that they totally disrupted. I'll give you a perfect example. Because of Amazon and iTunes, you don't go to a record store anymore. They're gone. Much to my chagrin, I used to love them. Orders, Circuit City. I have a feeling Best Buy they're struggling. So I don't know, it's hard to, I think it's still too early to tell, but if I were, like I said, the senior management at Harris Teeter, I'd be watching this closely because you can be sure that Amazon is gonna change some of the rules of how people buy groceries. That's for sure, just don't know how. But, so how do you think Amazon differentiates themselves? Let me ask you, do you think they, do they have any competition?
They do.
Not with that,
though.
No.
Well, eBay.
eBay. Yeah, I mean, in certain aspects. eBay's more of a different market segment, though. It's not, they're not competing head-to-head with Amazon.
No, not at all. I can't think of anybody.
Maybe Walmart, to some degree, but...
You mean a brick and mortar?
Well, I think Walmart's trying to give Amazon a run for their money.
Yeah, I'd say the other way around, yeah.
Yeah. But they're not, I don't know how successful they're going. I mean, here's an example of a company that really doesn't have, I mean, they have just eliminated a lot of their competitors.
I think the big difference with Walmart is there's a perception that Walmart already has a different set of, like something else comes up to people's minds when they think about buying at Walmart, even if it's online.
Right.
It's like, you on Walmart you can also buy most of the same things. And they also do two-day delivery.
Right.
But it's Walmart, people have certain...
So there's a certain stigma, or there's a certain,
yeah.
There's a certain, well, I mean, there is a certain emotional bond, whether it's good or bad, with Walmart.
Yeah.
And I'm reading from what you're telling me that it's somewhat negative. Is that right? Am I right?
But when it's about buying online, it's definitely negative.
Okay. So Walmart maybe hasn't established the credibility that Amazon has for online buying. Yeah, I agree with that.
But I mean, Walmart's image seems to be cheap prices, low prices, right?
Yep.
That what comes to mind.
Right. Here's one thing I think that differentiates Amazon hugely, and a lot of people have had to follow suit. They're the ones that revolutionized what I call user reviews. How many of you, when you're looking at something on Amazon, look at the user reviews? That was pretty much started by Amazon. And now, you go online, you go to Amazon's site, and they got a statistical analysis, we're going from 5 stars down to 1 star. But now, in this day and age, Amazon made it okay that you will trust the review of somebody that you don't even know for a product. Nobody else is doing it.
Well, eBay bases all practically their whole reputation on the reputation of the seller.
Right.
And that was done by evaluation. So if you don't get a star rating, you're out of business on eBay.
Right.
I don't know who preceded, but.
But there's all this whole idea, though, that you have to be authentic and you've got to be honest and you can't be pulling shady tricks.
Right. Well, especially because it's in the virtual environment.
Right.
Know?
And
that was eBay's whole entire reputation was based on that you could trust the seller.
Right.
That he would deliver, and if there was a problem, he would take it back.
He would take care of it. Or he would resolve it in some way.
Right.
Okay. Well, let's go. How about Apple? What do you think? What do you think their competitive advantage is? Let's start. Who do you think? Who is Apple's competition?
Samsung.
Sorry, and the phones at Samsung. So what would you say, how do you think, why would people buy an iPhone versus a Samsung?
They
don't explode.
I have to stay
there. Yeah, that kind of hurt. That definitely differentiated Samsung.
Yes.
But is there any thoughts about why you would buy an iPhone over a Samsung device? Right. Okay, just easy to use, it's cool, it pretty much sets itself up. And also Apple has done a huge job both in their products but as a company, being on the forefront of technology here's another example I think that really clearly differentiated Apple. All been to the Apple store, either out in South Point or at Crabtree? I mean, the place is always packed with people. Why do you think that's true? Why is that the case? I also would submit that maybe it's also, you know, the people that work there. You got all different kinds of people. Some of them are geeks. Some of them are not. But they seem like they seem like me. Just regular people. And they understand that I'm trying to solve a problem with my computer, or I'm trying to get a phone that's going to do it, and they seem like, okay, we'll help you out. They ask questions, how are you going to use it? What kinds of things? I mean, I think that's huge.
What about their situation of always coming out with the product and then coming out with 2 more behind it?
Right.
And then they said we're going to put the 9 or 10 release. And it's just money to me. I mean, they're just, you know, this is how much it's going to cost you. And they can't stay with the product. I know they're moving technology.
Right.
But it just seems like people are throwing a lot of money.
Well, I guess I would say you're asking why they do this.
I don't know how they keep a customer base if they keep doing new, better. I mean, because you can't keep up monetarily with the average person.
They do.
I would argue there's a lot of people out there that like to buy their new Wizzy phone. Okay? They do. And trust me, Apple's done a lot of research to verify that. So if there's a market, and I know there is, there are people out there that want to have the latest and greatest. And you want to know, this goes back to what we talked about. Because they want to be, some people, they want to be able to go out, to, when they're out drinking with their friends, look at me, I got the latest iPhone. Because that makes them feel good. I mean, there's besides the technical pieces, there's emotional reasons why people buy products. I want the latest and greatest, I want the coolest phone.
And all the phone companies help them because they have these little the new things where you can just pay monthly. You can change the phone whenever you want, just pay monthly.
It's like leasing it.
Yeah, yeah. To get it, so.
And there are people that want that. They're like, every 2 years they get a new phone.
Yeah, or every year, whenever Apple comes out with a new
Right, they get, you know, whatever Apple comes out with a new model, you get it.
Yeah.
But, you
know, the good thing about it is your
old
one still works.
Right. Your old one still works. It doesn't stop working because they come up with something new. You can keep that old one until you decide that you want something new.
That's true. But I would say that, that you know, that they've understood that there are people out there that want the latest and greatest. Okay, let's just wrap this up a little bit on the differentiation. Would anybody like to tell me their company, what do they think what do you think your competitive advantage is? So, the answer, somebody comes up to you and says, why should I buy your product over the competition? Well, how would you respond?
You say please.
You say please? Well, that might work, but I think it's if you don't, it's important to think about that. And this is also, as I mentioned earlier before, there are many large companies, large, that really do not have a handle on this at all. And they got Harvard MBAs. Understanding your competition. Why should I care about it? I mean, we talked about this competition. So why should we care about our competition? Or should we care about it? Should we care about it? Okay, why?
Because they're going to be, if you got something and they got the same thing, if they get a better product, you're left in behind because you're going to go to your better product. Mm-hmm. They're offering a better service. Better product, they're going to get your customers and they're going to take your customers. Mm-hmm. So if you're not moving, you're going to lose. You're going to get your customers.
Okay, so we all agree that we have to understand who our competition is and what they're doing in the marketplace. Yes? We agree? Okay, well, how do we do that? How do you figure out what your competition's doing?
Go to their web page.
That's a start.
It is.
There's some.
Send somebody over undercover shopper.
Yeah. One of the things, here's a few things you want to look at when you're doing a competitive, we call it a competitive analysis, all right? And this is another part of a marketing strategy is doing a comprehensive competitive analysis on every competitor that you have, not just as a whole, but every competitor. How is your competitor, how is company Y, your company X, how is company Y viewed in the marketplace? By your existing and potential customers, the people that you are trying to reach, how do they view your competition? It's really important to understand that.
Well, how do you get that information?
I'm setting it up. Can you, as a result of your analysis, are you able to assess what your competition's strengths and weaknesses are? You want to know that too. You want to know what they're good at, and what they're not good at, and you need to understand what you are good at and what you're not good at, because you're not going to be good at everything. But ideally, what you want to be is you want to be good at the things your competition is weak at. Okay? And that's, and the whole goal here is we're trying to improve our competitive advantage. All right, let me answer your question. How do we get competitive info? Whether marketing collateral, the website, any type of brochures that they have, flyers, white papers, I mean, anything the company publishes, articles that are written by, I'm gonna go through, definitely you can find out things there. Check out their advertising. Sales brochures, okay? Articles that they've written, you know, any industry articles, where do they talk? Because a lot of times in industry articles, they'll be talking about their latest product or their latest solution. Online databases, again, we're going back to the library. Check online beta, try to find out. You can use Reference USA and other things to research companies. Find out all kinds of things about them. You can check your financial statements. I don't have that on here, but checking the financial statement, you'd like to know how they're doing financially. If they're a public company, that information is available. Okay, industry trade shows. Many of us have been to trade shows, and you know, we always gotta do the old stealth checking out the competition spoof, right? And you know, hide your badge so they can't see what company you're from, right? All done then. And that's always a way, because they're doing it to you too, so you might as well, right? But that's a great way to find out about what your competition's doing. And you might want to find out who they're talking to at the show too. Talk to your sales force, if you have one. You know, what are they seeing out there? Talk to former employees. Maybe in a particular company in the industry, you know, some industries, they're pretty small and everybody kind of knows everybody. And if you see, you know, your competitor and you've got somebody that used to work there, I would absolutely talk to them. Find out how the company works. But to, you know, as long as they tell you everything that, you know, they don't breach your confidentiality agreement, but other than that, it's fair game to find out, you know, what's going on. That's what I definitely do that. And then your own observations. I mean, you're a smart person. You can judge what you see. There's a lot of ways. But again, it gets back to research. And then this is an example of what we call a SWOT analysis. And SWOT stands for strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And as I mentioned before, you want to do one of these on every one of your competitors. Understand, what are they good at? What are they not so good at? What opportunities do you see for them in the marketplace as a result of their doing? I mean, and then how are they a threat to your business? This is just a top level analysis. I mean, this gets broken down into a lot of sub things where there's a lot more tactical information that makes this up. Because one of the things we need to do is that we need to compose this so that, as again, as part of our marketing strategy, we know how we're going to compete head to head with this company. And if we don't know anything about them, and if we don't know this information, we're not going to be able to compete effectively. So again, you need to do one of these for every competitor. Okay, all right, we've got 15 minutes left. You guys still with me here?
Question?
Yes, sir.
You know, the information that you gather on your competition doesn't seem very empirical. It seems more anecdotal, or, you know what I'm saying? How can you really generate that? I mean, it's your opinion.
Right.
Or somebody else's opinion about it. It's not really like data.
Well, it's you know, doing a competitive analysis is not an exact science. And there's a certain amount of, I will tell you, there's a certain amount of error associated with that because you don't have firsthand. You're not, in a lot of the information, it's not going to be firsthand. Obviously, the company's not going to tell you.
Right.
Okay? So you have to get the information from sources that are available to you. And there's error associated with that. So, and I mean, so, but I would still say that despite that, you still need to do it.
Well, there's value to it, you know, but it's not data. It's not like the income statement.
Right. Although you may be able to, if it's a publicly held company, you can look at their financial statements.
Yeah, but that's data. That's not what I'm asking about.
Right.
I'm saying, you're asking, were you satisfied with this person? Were they knowledgeable? What, you know, did they, what are their strengths, right?
Right.
Are they asked in response when there's a problem? You know, things like that. Some of those things can be measured. But that information would seem very difficult to me.
Yeah, no, I understand. Anybody have a thought on that? And how to deal with that?
Just a thought, that's all.
And that's, I would say this, is that you want to try to get, when you're talking about, you know, customer interactions, for your competent, larger sample sizes, larger populations are better than smaller populations.
That's true. You know, but I'm saying, like, differentiate. That's something that's measurable. Target market. That's something that you can go out and measure. Mm-hmm. You can get a demographic
statement.
You know, but other things, I'm a little weary of that, you know.
Okay.
I mean, I do it in my own business. I size up what they're doing, you know what I'm saying? And, like, based on my past experience, we kind of find the medium where they do this and I do that, and we leave each other alone.
Okay.
You know,
right.
You know,
sure.
It's a different market down here, though. Know? It's a very different market.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So.
All right. Okay. We'll. I think what we'll do is we'll do the marketing budget, and I think we'll stop there. Okay. Okay. So hopefully, through all of this, I've convinced you that you need to invest in marketing. Okay? Well, how much do you need to invest? What's the right number? And, you know, what does that make up? How are you going to spend that money? So these are good questions that you need to answer. I'll try to give you an overview here. I look at it. A lot of people will talk about this. I talk about a marketing budget in four main buckets. And you can change it around, but I got what I call an empowering concept. That's the total thrust of what you're trying to do, what you're trying to help your customer do. Okay? And that's, I'll give you some examples in a minute, but that's sort of the cornerstone of how you are. When we talked about your value proposition, we help customers X, okay, blank. Your empowering concepts, how you help customers achieve their goals. Then there's other marketing programs that we talk about that need to be done that are a variety of outlets, and I'll give you some more examples. There's technology, and there's a technology investment that needs to be done, that needs to be made. We are living in a digital age, and you do need to invest in technology to help you with your marketing efforts. And manpower. Now, whether you hire somebody or you do it yourself, there is manpower that needs to be done. It's going to need to be included. And typically, whoever you do, whether it's yourself or somebody else, they don't work for nothing. So you have to budget for their compensation. Okay, the empowering concept is helping your target audience achieve their mission, okay? How are you going to do that? You're addressing the challenge that they're facing, okay? Help them address the challenges that they are facing. That's what you're trying to do. All right, here's some examples, and I did this for my business, all right? My empowering concepts are like what I'm doing today, conducting webinars and in-person workshops to share marketing essentials. And other things that I might want to do is I might want to create awareness within my target market about complementary and ancillary businesses to the renewable energy market and make sure that people understand about that. What I'm trying to do is create a sense of local unity at the state level. Okay. But these are just, again, helping my customers achieve their goals. Okay. All right, we've got marketing programs. And say, for example, we have a launch event. And maybe this launch event is a new product that you're introducing. Or it is a, you're going to be at some big show. Your business is going to be exhibiting at a big show. Or you're bringing on, you're moving into a new facility. I don't know. Whatever the event is that is going to have some impact on your customer. Well, there's programs that you're going to need to put in place to build up to this launch event. And what they become and what we talk about is that you've got your long tail events, the medium tail, and the short tail. And what we talk about here is the long tail is just like it means. These are marketing initiatives that are initiated well in advance of the launch event because by their very nature, they take a long time to implement or they require time for the target audience to respond to whatever you want them to do. And then we have the medium tail and then the short tail. And let me see if I can give you some examples here. This presentation shows up. There we go. Yeah, good. Okay, here's some examples of some long tail events. Now, we all know that back in the 20th century, you had a lot of things we call print PR, print ads, TV commercials, other types of things. These are what we call long tail promotion. They take a long time for the reach to reach the audience. Okay, and they are, by their very nature, require a certain amount of time between the time you initiate it till you get the proper customer response that you want. Okay. Then we have what we call our medium tail. And there's a few things about that. There's a few examples that you can read there that are more, the touch with the customer is more frequent. For example, you know that if you're going to be at a industry trade show, maybe you want to send a series of emails to certain people to let them know that you're going to be there. Maybe you're going to be introducing a new product that you've been talking with them about, but you want to have communications with them on a timely basis and more than once, because your goal is that you want them to come to your booth or you want to meet with them at the show. So you want to put these things in place. And then the short-tailed ones are this is like using Twitter, putting tweets out there, maybe a Facebook post, LinkedIn, you can put a LinkedIn post on there about, hey, we're gonna be at XX Trade Show. Hope you can come by and check out our booth, that sort of thing. But this just gives you an idea of what the point here is to show that these are, they incrementally in terms of the amount of time it takes to implement these. Okay. Okay. Next one, personnel. Now I'll just say that personnel this is probably gonna be the largest portion of your budget. The types of people that you may need. Someone to manage your marketing content. Somebody that helps with the management of your tools. Maybe you need that, maybe you don't, but I put it in there. You may need a marketing assistant to help with some of the work that you're doing. Maybe not. And then if you're going to be visiting customers and going to shows and other types of things, you've got to have a budget for a travel budget for being at events. Technology and tools. Your website, CRM tool, you heard CRM, how many of you know, customer relationship management tool? Okay, everybody's heard that. And then databases, you may have need to get access to databases that this library doesn't provide. There's a chance that you need, in order to do some of your research, or you need to, you know, need some specific information that's not available in the free market.
Could you amplify on customer relationship management tool? What is that?
That is a
software or something?
Excuse me?
Is it a software program?
Typically it's software. Have you ever heard of Salesforce? Okay. CRM tool, it is really it's a database that you can put in, and really what it is every time you have an interaction with one of your prospective clients, it's a place to put that information so that you can keep track of, maybe keep track of all your customer prospects, and you also want to know where they are in the marketing funnel. Because some are, you know, you've got some contacts that you just had one conversation and they just, maybe they are aware of you, but they really won't. It's still a ways out, okay? And then you have others that are much closer to becoming customers.
Right.
But the whole point of the CRM tool is to keep that all straight.
Okay.
So, yeah. Okay, now the next slide I show you is gonna have some numbers. They're made up numbers, but they are for developing your marketing ROI, okay? But before I do that, I just remember that I want to talk a little bit about websites, just a few comments about websites. How many people have gone to websites and they're beautiful looking sites, and you scroll through the pages and you come back and you say, I have no idea what this customer is. Okay. Well, don't let that be your website. There's a lot of pretty websites out there, but they're not serving their purpose. In my mind, your website, and everybody needs to have a website now. You have to have a website. It's a price of admission nowadays. I say it has to answer three fundamental questions. And this is something Roar, we do a lot of website strategies and help people with their messaging on that. First one, what is your company known for? Okay? Why are you in business? Okay? And these are very broad, but I mean, this is what needs to be, and I would say this needs to be on your landing page. First page they come to, okay? Second one, who does your company serve? Who is your target audience? You want it so that when the people that you want to sell to come to your site, they feel like they're home. He's talking to me, she's talking to me, okay? That's the biggest, probably the biggest thing you don't see. You see customers, let me finish. And then the third one, and then I'll make another comment. And this is the competitive advantage. Why should customers buy from you? And that should be all on your landing page. I've seen so many websites where you go there and they just talk about themselves. It is not about you. That's where you get what we call the high bounce rates. Because you go to a website, in this day and age, where we are bombarded with information daily, and we get what we call information fatigue, we skim things and we're just reading them. Somebody comes to your site, and within the first 2 or 3 seconds, if they don't find anything that's interesting to them or what they're looking for, they're gonna leave. Call that a bounce rate. And if you can answer these questions, chances are really good they won't leave. Like I said, it should be on the landing page. You should have a crisp value proposition. We help customers X. Okay? The top fold. And it's optimized. Because you're providing information for your prospective customers. the information that they want. And typically, it's not about you or your company. Save that for later. When it gets towards the discovery side of the funnel. Okay. This is the marketing budget, and I'm just going to say, in mine, I had, if I was going to do a full year, this is, I made up some numbers here, but the biggest number here is in personnel. And there's some other things that I do. One of the things I did here is I made a pilot. And I said, maybe what I would do, instead of some of the initiatives that I'm going to be working on, I will do a 3-month pilot to see how they're going. I'm not going to spend all the money right away. And that is really good, because what you want to do on some things is to determine if they're going to be effective or not. And that's where we talk about that measurement. But there's certain investments in technology, for example, database infrastructure and some of your personnel. They're going to be the same. I mean, well, I'm sorry, the technology will be the same. And your website, I mean, that's kind of a sunk cost. Certain things are going to be sunk costs that you're going to have to invest in, whether you do a pilot or not. Anyway, so that is the end of the budget, and we are at 8:30 here, so I guess what I'd like to do before I get the rest of the information is in the presentation. Please look it over. If you have any questions, please reach out to me. If any of you would care to, you can connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm easy to find, Ken Wood. I'd be happy to connect with you. If there's anything I can do to help you, please reach out to me. I'm done.
Thanks, Ken. Great presentation. Key marketing. You know, of all the clients I counseled the last 5 years, I'd say the marketing stuff, identifying who you're trying to sell to and what your message is probably the biggest need.